So we'll get started. Thanks everybody for coming today. I'm Amy Allen from the philosophy department, and I'm going to kind of moderate today's thesis defense. So I'm happy to, well, first let me tell you the process. So Nathan Gusdorf is going to give a presentation maybe for about 10 or 15 minutes with an overview of his thesis project. And then our convention is that the second reader, who is Professor Walden, will ask the first couple of questions. And then the first reader, that's myself, will ask the second set of questions, maybe one or two, depending on how time's going. And then we'll open it up to general discussion questions from the audience. Hopefully we'll have about 20 minutes left for that. So that's the plan. So I'm happy to introduce Nathan Gusdorf, and the title of his thesis is Adornian Marxism, the Concept of Critique.
Thank you all for coming, very much. Thank you to my mom, who came here from St. Louis. And thank you to my readers, Professors Amy Allen and Kenny Walden. So this is a project that started about 2 years ago in the fall of my junior year. A friend, who's actually the Italian resident here and a philosophy student, had basically recommended Adorno. I decided that I wanted to do an independent study. Fortunately, Amy Allen happens to be pretty well read in matters of critical theory, being essentially a member of the contemporary Frankfurt School. So I started studying Theodore Adorno. That winter, I did more independent research on Adorno, and then the summer before my senior year, I started working on my thesis. So this has been a long time in the making in terms of reading and thinking about a lot of these themes and concepts. The way that I'm going to do this, as Professor Allen explained, is give a short presentation and then open it up to questions. There are a few different elements to this whole discussion. The sort of core of it, and the most essential one for the philosophical discussion, is, as the title suggests, Adorno's concept of critique. So that's really going to be situated in German philosophy and Kant and Hegel, and talking about the conceptual issues in the idea of self-reflection, in reason, critiquing itself. But at the same time, there's some broader issues that are really important to my thesis and important to understanding what's going on here with the historical Frankfurt School and with some other people who are involved. So I'm going to talk very briefly about what the Frankfurt School is and then pretty much move into Adorno. And in terms of questions, as I see it, there are basically two kinds of questions you can ask me. You can challenge the things I say and ask me to like explain them better because they seem wrong or don't make sense, or you can just ask me to explain what I mean. For those of you who aren't versed in Frankfurt School theory, you don't have to challenge my claims, but if there's anything that you're interested in or doesn't make sense, please just ask me to keep talking, because there's just not enough time to really explain everything that I want to talk about that's in my thesis, but I'm interested in making this interesting and informative for all of you. So, with that said, critical theory is actually a very broad term today. For those of you who come out of the humanities and the artistic disciplines, it really refers to a very like broad field of theory that's used in interpretive work. What we're talking about here is actually something considerably narrower. It comes out of the University of Frankfurt from the Institute for Social Research, which was started in the 1920s as an interdisciplinary center for Marxist study. What this means is that they're going to take philosophy, economics, political science, and really political economy, psychoanalysis, and sociology, and build them into something of an integrated platform for studying and criticizing capitalist society in this sort of late manifestation in the early 20th century. That's the idea. The people who are working there are some of the most interesting and complicated thinkers of the 20th century, so they all kind of go their own ways. Adorno, in my opinion, is the most interesting and profound philosophically. So that's really why I'm working with him. Now, the idea of critical theory is that critical theory is, in this Marxist mode, situated in conditions of political struggle. That philosophy in critical theory moves from its traditional task of sort of analyzing eternal truths of reason through speculation alone, to looking at the conditions of consciousness in society, specifically in capitalist society. The basic idea is that power, conditions of political and economic power, sociological power, and historical circumstance are the things that shape our beliefs and our ways of thinking about the world. So when we reflect on our concepts, when we engage in conceptual analysis, which is the traditional activity of philosophy, what we're dealing with isn't sort of like the ether of reason, but matters that are rooted in historical circumstance. But it's not just historicism, it really is analytical reflection. So with that said, there are three things that feature in my thesis. One is Dialectic of Enlightenment, which is one of the sort of major first texts of Frankfurt School critical theory. It's co-authored by Theodor Adorno and Max Horkheimer, his colleague, both philosophers and sociologists. And this really set the stage for a lot of subsequent work in critical theory and applications of critical theory. So it's one of really the earliest statements of the program of Frankfurt School critical theory. Then Adorno is my guy. I'm going to move on to him in a minute because that's what really matters here. And then there's this other character who features Jürgen Habermas. I don't like Habermas very much. He is Adorno's successor at the Frankfurt School. It really goes through generations. So right now we're sort of on the third or fourth generation. That's what Amy Allen is involved in. Habermas is the second generation. So the first generation, they're like all these critical Jewish Marxists who fled Germany and then came back after the Nazi regime fell. They're really interesting and important for a lot of the humanities. Habermas really does something different. I'm not going to talk about him terribly much because my thesis is in effect a criticism of Habermas. The discussion of Adorno is positioned against Habermas, saying that Habermas misunderstands Adorno. So when he builds out this new direction for critical theory from like the 60s to the 80s, that's actually based on a misunderstanding of his predecessors. And so the overarching aim here is actually to reread his predecessors and say, no, this is really what's going on in Adorno's thought. And so that's what I'm going to talk about right now. And this is really the philosophical core of my thesis. Adorno is fundamentally concerned with the concept of critique. And this begins with Kant. That means, in a word, reason reflecting on itself. Kant says, rather than engaging reason to analyze and criticize texts and empirical data from science and works of art, let's use reason to examine reason. And so he finds that when we reflect and recognize ourselves as cognizing subjects, we realize that we have really these conceptual structures of thought that we use to understand the world, and that it's really unavoidable, that we can't get away from having these conceptual structures of thought. But what we can do is see which ones are really built into consciousness, which ones are unavoidable, what sort of concepts are fundamental, and that will show us the limits of reason, what we can and what we cannot know. Again, we can talk about that more later, but the thing that really matters for Adorno is the idea that reason is reflecting on itself, and it's this moment of self-awareness that is critique, that performs a critical function in showing us the limits of our understanding and those things that we think we understand which we actually don't understand. Now Adorno wants to take that concept of reflective critique and track it through Hegel, who's really a successor to Kant's project in his view. And this is where it gets kind of messy. But Hegel really comes up with the idea of the historical dialect. So for Kant, reflection brings us to fairly foundational, rooted structures of cognition that don't change through time. In Hegel, these structures change through time. And on Adorno's reading, the thing that really provokes our structures of reason to change is reflection. Right? So there's a lot of other stuff going into Hegel, but basically the idea is that when we reflect on our own consciousness, we come to the limits of our understanding. But against Kant, who thought that those limits didn't change, in his Hegelian mode, says those limits in being cognized are then overcome. So it's fairly abstract, but the idea is that we're always sort of rooted in certain structures, certain conceptual modes of understanding the world, and that as we come to understand them, the limits that they thereby created on our understanding then fall. Right? We've then surpassed them. And so this is really the critical moment for Adorno. The idea that in reflecting on our own thought, we can overcome those limitations. And this is where we get to the Marxian Adorno. To the Adorno whose concern with critique is a political activity. Because in the Marxist mode, where we're concerned with the ways in which history and politics and economics affect our consciousness, the concepts that we discover that structure our understanding and our experience of the world are no longer something like esoteric and of the substance of reason. Right? They're very much rooted in material circumstances. And if we sort of take an easy example out of Marxism, we might say that a lot of people believe in efficient, effective markets as a way to distribute goods. And this is considered ideology in the sense that these are beliefs that are structured out of conditions of power in capitalist society that are mistakenly understood as being true, right? Rather than as being something that reinforces the status quo. And so the idea here is that through critical reflection, the realization is that those conceptual structures, the ideas of markets, come to us out of a material world that makes plausible the idea of markets because the ruling class is basically enabled by market power. That doesn't mean that markets actually do all the things we think they do, right? We have those beliefs sort of delusionally because it's a plausible understanding of the world. So this is a very basic Marxist critique of market ideology. What we can do with Adorno is show how critique can be leveled against ideological beliefs, and conversely, show how the absence of critique is the thing that creates the conditions for ideological beliefs. And it would go something like this. When we reflect in this critical way where we're concerned with power on our beliefs about markets, we realize that those are ideas that come to us from the world rather than from, you know, truth itself. And then we realize that actually by believing in them, we're reinforcing the status quo, and that enables us to overcome those beliefs. Now, the converse, the absence of critique. It is that if you don't reflect, right, if your consciousness just sort of gets settled in those normal ways of thinking, that becomes plausible because you have a world that tells you that all of those beliefs really make sense, that that is how the world works. And because you're not reflecting on it, because you're not becoming aware that this is something you think, because you can't engage with it critically and challenge it, it becomes reified. It becomes made real. Literally, the real world is the thing that sort of bolsters and supports this understanding, and it can carry along happily because you've refused to take the reflective step that would enable you to challenge it. Okay, so these are sort of the two prongs of Adornian critique, and the thing that gets kind of sticky with Adorno is that he doesn't think that there's any bottom line. So in Hegel, with this whole dialectical progression of thought through time, he posited a final stage of absolute knowing, where we'd come through all these contradictory stages, we would reflect on our beliefs, and they would change dynamically, but then we would ultimately come to absolute knowledge. Adorno's major philosophical work is called Negative Dialectics because he thinks that the negative moment, this moment where you realize that the way you understand the world is in fact false, that it's no longer plausible because of the degree to which you've investigated it, that's always going to be present, that the dialectic never ends. That creates some problems. It's also fairly interesting because it means that philosophy is always going to return to the real world and be rooted in the sort of reality of its analysis, whether that's looking at literature or art or politics or social science, say, these are all going to exhibit conditions of consciousness, structures of cognition, and the activity of conceptual reflection is always going to lead to a negative moment. We're always going to realize that it just doesn't quite measure up. But that's, for Adorno, not a problem, because he doesn't need us to arrive at some sort of final theoretical truth about the world, because for him, philosophy isn't actually about arriving at that moment. For him, philosophy is essentially a critical, engaged task that's always about realizing what we don't understand, and it's always about engaging with the conditions of unreflective thought. That really brings it all back into critical theory and the conditions of political power. We don't need to go into that right now, because this whole package from Kant to Hegel, and then Marxianizing it. That's really the essence of my thesis. That's the major project here, and that is Adornian critique.
So, as you say, you're not very keen on Habermas, and one of the big projects of your thesis is to respond to Habermas's criticism that the kind of critique we find in Dialectic of Enlightenment is totalizing, and so leaves us in a moment of confusion, of aporia. And I was wondering if you could say a bit more about what it takes for a critique not to be totalizing. So for a critique not to be totalizing, does there have to be something, a proposition or a method or a rule of inference that isn't held up to scrutiny? So Habermas has an argument that the conditions of communicative reason have a status like this because if you try to critique them or reject them, you end up in the kind of pragmatic contradiction. Does Adorno have an analogous argument that would lead to a similar claim about negative dialectics? And if he doesn't, how do we keep from sliding into the dread totalizing critique?
Yeah. All right, so that's a really good question, and now I can talk about Habermas. So Habermas's reading of Dialectic of Enlightenment is that, all right, so Dialectic of Enlightenment is basically the sort of philosophical, historical study of Enlightenment reason, both in sort of the like classical 18th century European sense and more generically, really, in the sense of like scientific rationalizing and systematizing. Their problem that they're trying to understand in Dialectic of Enlightenment is how what seemed like the height of European civilization and what seemed like this really intellectually rich progressive tradition ended up with fascism and the Holocaust. It's understandably a fairly depressing book. But Habermas's reading is that they say the dialectic of enlightenment, the historical progression of enlightenment, is one that ultimately leads logically necessarily to the complete identification of reason and power. And so this means something like our theoretical programs enable us to have certain effects on the world, right? Especially in science, we have these theories and they enable us to manipulate the natural world. But we should keep those separate, right? There's our speculative faculty for trying to understand the world, and then there's having certain effects. And Habermas reads Dialectic of Enlightenment as saying, well, that ability to have effects, to have power over the world, that actually displaces everything in the concept of reason. So reason just is power, the ability to manipulate. And then the effect that that has, the totalizing critique that Kenny was talking about, he says that the book basically concludes that all of our reason is now corrupted by power because we're incapable of grounding validity claims. We're incapable of showing that something really is a claim of reason rather than just a product of power. And so he reads it as a fundamentally skeptical treatment of reason, right? That they're just skeptical of the possibility of ever grounding anything rationally. Now, I don't think that Adorno is going to have a way to say, look, here's a theory that is impenetrable, here's something that you can't reject because it would be contradictory. But I think the distinction to make is that Adorno's response to reason, so to speak, isn't a skeptical one, it's a critical one. I'll explain what that means. Habermas reads him as skeptical, right? Is basically ending in this moment where he says, look, we can never really know, there's really no hope for reason. Adorno, the idea of the negative dialectic, that it sort of always goes on, that there's always going to be a critical moment, that's actually not static, right? It's not skeptical, because skepticism might be the initial stage, where we're skeptical that our beliefs are really true. So then we think about them, and we realize that they're not really true. But it doesn't stay there. It actually generates a new concept. This is actually what's really Hegelian about his thought, and it's the idea of determinate negation, which has to be contrasted with abstract negation. So the abstract negation of a belief would be to just say no, to put a little not signifier in front of it, to say, well, we believe that the world is flat, but that's not the case. Determinate negation is really to replace, to supplant that concept with one that does a lot of similar work, but is fundamentally incompatible with it. So the example that I use in my thesis is that we can imagine monotheism as a form of determinate negation. That we start out trying to understand the world, and we frame it out in terms of gods, many different gods with many different powers. And then we think about the fact that we have this polytheistic structure for understanding the universe, and it starts to not match up to our intuitions. It starts to break down in some places. So through that process of criticism, you create a new concept of a single god that's all in. And so this determinately negates the polytheistic beliefs. Right? It's you can't believe them both at the same time. They're contradictory. But the monotheistic concept does a lot of the same work. It now helps you understand the world better. Right? So critique is always a process of generating new concepts that are in contradiction with, but also supplant our former understandings. And so the negative dialectic carries on through determinate negations. And that means that Adorno is skeptical of ever having an ending point, but he's equally skeptical of ever having a point of total knowledge or a point of total skepticism. His dialectical method is one that's always going to generate new modes of understanding. And so in that sense, it's not totalizing, because we never end up saying, oh, I guess reason can't do anything. We're always engaged in the process of reasoning. We're always engaged in the process of reflection and conceptual construction. It just sort of never settles, right? It's never completely true. But that doesn't permit us to abstain from it.
This is more of a follow-up. What if someone came along and said, as a matter of fact, all conceptual schemes are equally good? And so your process of the kind of transition between conceptual schemes that you talk about isn't actually a form of critique at all. Can Adorno entertain that kind of critique of his critical apparatus?
I've actually been thinking about that a fair amount because I was reading Nelson Goodman, and I actually found, I think, a lot of similarities in a certain way. This is where I'd say that Adorno's method is, in a sense, it's not really phenomenological, right? But sort of in the way that like Kant is thinking from the perspective of the cognizing subject, Adorno is as well. So he would say, well, it's not really a question of whether we get to a better one or a worse one. It's a question of like, once you're situated within some way of thinking about the world, once you have this conceptual framework, you're either thinking about it or you're not, right? You're reflecting on it and trying to understand it better, or you're not. And if you're not, then you basically have hypostasized consciousness, you become uncritical, this is a condition of ideology, and likewise political oppression. And if you're thinking about it, then you can't but start to negate it. So we don't even really have the choice of like sort of picking out different ways to understand the world. We understand the world in a certain way that might be composed of multiple possibilities, and as we try to work through them, we understand them better and we fill out their content, and they might be contradictory and incompatible. But within one particular way of thinking about the world, we're also going to discover elements that are contradictory and incompatible. So this sort of field of possibilities dissolves into really the constellation is the image that he always uses, right? A constellation of different concepts and different conceptual structures that are all sort of entangled and irresolvable, but still meaningful.
Could you say a bit more about why the process of critique and change is always going to keep going on? So in the thesis you talk about, Adorno has this sort of transcendental idealist view. The idea that a concept is never adequate to an object.
Right.
But that doesn't seem to prevent or forefront the possibility that I could get into a conceptual scheme that's sort of self-reinforcing. All the modes of critique and reflection I have all say, yeah, this is great. It might be that as sort of metaphysical matter, that's keen, isn't adequate to reality as it really is, but there's still no internal sort of mechanism for me to get into the flow of the determinate negation, as it were.
Sure.
What's the guarantee that this isn't going to stop at some point, that we're not
going to... That's a pretty good question. He doesn't have any guarantee. His claim that there's always going to be a negative moment is almost empirical in a way, right? I mean, not in an empiricist way, but he says, it's actually, we just sort of understand this, right? Like, The experience of thinking is the experience of moving through these negations, and sort of that's just what comes with the territory. It's possible that you never come to a moment of negation, but I mean, I think he would just say, then you're not really thinking, and that's all there is to it.
Okay.
There's no, I mean, because he doesn't even like have really fundamental theoretical claims that are going to generate everything.
So if I keep, you know, it could be that there's some, you know, arcane bit of knowledge that has its own scheme, and I keep checking again and again and trying to think of new ways that it could be wrong and trying to undertake a revolution in this little bit of knowledge. But if I can't do it, does that mean I'm not being thoughtful? Or,
well,
or does it just mean that, like, oh, I'm stuck, but maybe I got right?
I think what it would mean is that the aim isn't so much to think about ways you could be wrong, but to understand that you're understanding the world in a particular way. So once you come to the realization that this is a conceptual structure for understanding the world, mm-hmm. then what you get is at least some sort of, you at least introduce the possibility of being incorrect. Right? Maybe you can't actually articulate why that is, mm-hmm. but then you create a sort of separation between your understanding and the world. And so what seemed maybe like a moment of naivete before, where you thought, no, this is just how it is. This, I can't figure out any ways in which this could be wrong. And then you say, okay, well, I'm still not, may not be able to articulate how it's wrong, but I do see that there's this sort of disjunction between the way that I understand and cognize the world and the world as it might really be.
Okay, so I wanted to ask a little bit about the connection to Marx, which you make through the idea of ideology, and also in the thesis more through Adorno's materialism.
Yeah.
But, I mean, the notions of ideology and materialism that you're getting out of Adorno strike me as pretty far from the way that Marx himself understood those concepts. So ideology, on your reading of Adorno, is more about what Lukács called reification than it is, I think, about ideology specifically as, you know, the ruling ideas of a time are always the ideas that benefit the ruling class, right? That very, and that sort of, in Marx, is related to materialism, where materialism means, I mean, it seems like in Adorno it means, in your reading of Adorno, it means that thought or conceptualization is rooted in the experience of some concrete particular. Whereas for Marx it means, you know, relations of production, right? Material economic conditions in it. So in a more specific, I guess I would say, conception of materialism. So I guess I would like to hear you say a little bit more about, the general question is about to what extent Adorno is really a Marxist. I mean, his conception of critique is actually Marxist, given that his understandings of these kind of Marxish sounding concepts are quite different, it seems to me. But maybe a more specific way to put it would be to say, is there something in Adorno's thought specifically about capitalism that generates these problems with identity thinking, with, you know, the tendency toward hypostasization, right? Or is that something that's kind of internal to, or sort of danger within the structure mm-hmm. of thinking itself that we have to always be on guard for? Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah. All right, let's see. So the second question is, interesting. I guess, right, so I'm thinking about like the Horkheimer's early article, Materialism and Metaphysics, and it may be, I mean, I don't know, this might involve intellectual history in some way, but it may be that like past modes of consciousness, because they're more metaphysical, actually involve more speculative work, more sort of like more abstract and indeterminate content, if you're thinking about gods, if you're thinking about magical powers, and so it can't be really precisely and concretely systematized to the degree that, say, like scientific and technical rationality can be in like capitalist society. And because you have, and so that creates an opening then in like former modes of consciousness, sort of for more reflection or for more like speculative critical work. Right? It's not fundamentally critical. There's always a possibility of hypostatization, but what's so sort of frightening and dominating for the Frankfurt School thinkers about like capitalism, I think, is that it seems like everything can be fit together. So you can sort of get rid of the gods, you can get rid of the unknown. I mean, this is why they're so critical of logical positivism, because the idea that you could have sort of like a set of tightly knit theoretical propositions, bound language, keep out vagueness and indeterminacy, and build science on top of that, so that you actually like do away with all of the openings and thought for speculation and reflection. Like sort of that's the most hypostasized consciousness, right? That's a form of consciousness that really doesn't permit any kind of critical reflection. So I think that may just be a problem that gets worse in capitalist society. And then to go to the first question about what makes him a Marxist, I think that like ideology really is the big thing. And the question for him is, I think it's a question of like which direction we go in. So it seems to me like on the classical Marxist theory, we sort of have a positive theory in which ideas come from the material world, and this is why the ruling ideas are the ideas of the ruling class. Adorno doesn't really want to posit any kind of explanatory theory in that way. So I think that what we can do with Adorno is say, all right, he gives us the, like basically he gives us the cognitive conditions for overcoming ideological consciousness. And then it's the absence of those conditions that, like, sort of solving backwards, shows us how ideology arises. So ideas come from wherever they come from. They come from society, they come from history. Like, sort of how we pick up the beliefs we pick up, I think, isn't something that he's concerned to explain or study. What he wants to understand is how it is that we have these beliefs that are situated in capitalist society that make us basically complacent with a lot of the features of capitalist society. And why is it that we don't see through those? Why don't we see that for what it really is? Well, that's a failure to be critical. It's a failure to engage critique. And sort of that's how reification works, right? So so it's still, I think that's still essentially Marxist, because you still have the material world playing this role of anchoring our ideological beliefs. The role of power in the material world is really essential to their concept of instrumental reason. And so like sort of the modes of, really the facets of Marxism that are concerned with explaining how structures of power replicate themselves are present in Adorno, but I think he approaches them from a different direction because he's dealing with theory in a different kind of way.
Okay, well, I wanted to ask another kind of question, which is about progress. So you say in the last chapter of the thesis that, I mean, this is related to one of Kenny's questions about, you know, is there any sort of part of Adorno's theory that would be immune to critique that could serve as a kind of point of view or something like that from which critique could be launched? And in talking about that in the thesis, you say we have to internalize a negative conception of progress. Progress as a march toward redemption of the kingdom of ends becomes implausible if we don't have a final goal for society or thought. And yet we can't abandon the belief that some things are better and some worse, so we have to have negation be the indicator of progress. And I just was curious to hear you say a bit more about what that means and how that can really work without either articulating
sure.
some point of view, right, beyond critical reflection, let's
right.
say, or on the other hand, I guess part of the background of this question is wondering whether or not it's really true, as you try to say in your response to Habermas, that
I mean, I think that we have to split the question into like a metaphysical question of progress and sort of an ethical question. So in terms of like marching towards progressively a complete like true theory of the world, evidently he's like highly skeptical of that. And his notion of progress in that sense itself, which he writes in this article called Progress, is one that, you know, is kind of negative dialectical in its own way. He says, you know, in thinking about, in exploring the concept of progress, we really can't do anything but realize that we're both sort of attached to this idea of an end that we posit, because it's really inherent in the concept, and yet at the same time, it somehow breaks down. It ends up full of contradictions. That's sort of its own thing. I think that sort of more basically we can just say, all right, so he thinks that the concept of progress is like any other concept on his view. It's all tangled up and difficult to systematize. It's actually impossible to systematize. So then what's the role of negation in thinking about progress? I think this is where Adorno becomes really relevant ethically and politically. That the value of the critical act of reflection isn't just epistemic. It doesn't just show us that we have false beliefs about the world. But that hypostasized consciousness, these sort of rigidified ways of thinking, are actually the condition of political oppression. So this is their analysis of Nazi Germany and Dialectic of Enlightenment. That thought becomes so reified, so set in its ways, and overly structured and immune to self-reflection, that anything that sort of threatens it or comes from the outside, anything that it hasn't accounted for and doesn't believe in, actually has to be destroyed. And Adorno more or less thinks that this very sedimented consciousness is actually basically the condition of political oppression. And so progress can then be something that's like ethical and negative both, because it's the breaking down of the condition for oppression. And so this is really his negativistic ethics. And so that's progress in the sort of like strict intuitive sense, where you say, all right, so fewer people are being killed, we're not engaged in structural oppression. That's a liberating moment, right? That's what's emancipatory about it. It emancipates us from these problematic, dangerous modes of consciousness. And that's a sort of different concept of progress, but still, I think, a very relevant and functional one in his view.
Okay, so we'll open up to general questions. And do you want to field them? Okay?
Yeah, Professor Mawade. Yeah.
I would just like to ask you if you, at some point, address something that I find extremely important for Adorno, and that also to a certain degree gets him out of that infinite loop of self-critique and critique, self-reflection of critique, namely that ultimately he believes to a certain degree that critique does the labor of justice, that critique has a redemptive function. And I think that even in the etymological purchase of the word critique, that's visible, or in his reading of Benjamin's thesis on romanticist critique. I just would like to ask you, do you at some point address the points where Adorno touches upon the greater questions of the dialectical tradition as it reflects on justice?
Justice is an interesting way to put it. I actually don't talk about that in my thesis, although that was the first thing I ever wrote on Adorno, was looking at, well, really the question of politics and sort of resistance and ethics in Adorno. I think that's the way to make sense of all of his work, really, and to make sense of this conception of critique.
For example, you start with Kant, right? The first, the preface of Kant's critique is all about the Copernican revolution, treating his own project as if it were a revolutionary one. So I think, to say that in that sense, Adorno fits right in. He pursues that very idea of critique.
Yeah, and I mean, this is in a lot of his later writings, especially because Adorno was criticized very often for being. A lot of people considered him apolitical, so he wasn't involved in a number of protests and actions of the later student movement in Germany. And so he wrote a lot of responses to people saying, like, oh, you're sort of just a bourgeois theorist, by saying, well, you know, the revolution in thought is actually essential to any revolutionary movement. So the capacity for emancipating ourselves from certain conditions of consciousness, that itself is maybe the most important political function. And so that's the kind of revolution that he really has in mind. Go back, Michael.
Yeah, I have a question that follows on what was just said, and that is, Adorno was accused by his younger and more radical disciples, including the student revolutionaries of 68 and 70s, of basically a kind of coy, asymptotic invocation of critique, in which there's never anything really happens. It's just you criticize, and there's this hope that it comes to some redemptive reflection, redemption, but the revolution is constantly postponed. And, you know, Marcuse, who was also in that circle, came to Berkeley and got more mixed it up with the student revolution. And he wrote a book about, he said, reflection and revolution, that if you take the dialectic seriously, you have the reflection, but it's not just reflection infinitely reflecting upon itself, thought thinking itself. It's thought coming to grips with the reality that must be changed on the basis of thought or forethought or something like that. And the whole revolution thing drops out of your presentation of critical theory, and that was a huge split. And you know, I do agree that sort of Habermas didn't like the transcendental totalizing of reflection reflecting endlessly on itself, and he turned it into sort of communication, conversation, like Richard Rorty. Let's keep the conversation going. Well, we can have a conversation infinitely, but if there's real injustice out there, you decide to say, well, by God, I'm going to occupy Wall Street, or I'm going, you see what I'm saying? a certain kind of deferred coyness about the situation is not yet ripe, you know, ripe for revolution.
I'm not sure, I don't know if Adorno has a good answer to that question. I mean, he sort of repeats himself and says, you know, yeah, but lots of these protesters have, like, uncritical hypostasized consciousness, so they're not doing the work or something. I guess that's really a political question, and all I can say is that I don't think Adorno gives us any political program or commitment to politics, but I don't think that he's actually completely removed from politics. I think that he can actually really be interestingly applied to politics, because Habermas, so in contrast to Habermas, who really gives us like conditions on just discourse and norm construction, Adorno doesn't do any of that, right? He gives us this like really powerful critical apparatus, and he might sit in his office mostly criticizing other people, but I think that it can actually be fairly readily sort of incorporated into political action. And Occupy Wall Street, I can fortunately speak to out of personal experience, but you know, we might actually be able to pit these two thinkers against each other and say, all right, so when we have these supposedly egalitarian democratic situations of political discourse, what's a more interesting and more helpful and more enabling way to think about it? Do we use this sort of like hyper-reflective Adornian critical mode, or do we make an appeal to Habermas's structures of discursive reason? And experientially, I'd say like Adornian approach is actually much more interesting and helpful. Because when you're actually engaged in politics, it doesn't really do much good to start talking about conditions of fair discourse, right? Because you actually have to act, and you actually have to make arguments. And so seeing uncritical consciousness and being able to articulate it actually becomes something that's very powerful in a political context. That's not necessarily a demand of critique, right? I'm not sure that it can be, but it's definitely a way of making it come to life. Professor Levy.
So just a couple quick questions. First is, so there's this optimism behind the idea of critique from inside. What's so great about self-reflection? Like, that's supposed to be the magic tool with which we get to. I mean, so there's a kind of long tradition of optimism about this. But why not think that that's just one more mode of thinking, which is just as handcuffed by its material economic circumstances as anything else? And although we might produce a whole bunch of new chatter when we apply it, that's just actually going to be one more expression of man. Right?
Sure.
Right? So that's the first question. Second question is, what's so, so the contrast between critique and hypostasized situation, where we want to say that's just ideological thoughtlessness, same sort of question, skeptical concern. So by definition, as long as the mind is still restless and asking these questions, we're not stuck in this other thing. But the restlessness in the mind seems like that might just be one more way of being, having the mind be captured. I'll take the game on and I'll do this thing, and that might keep me, academic as I am, happily occupied. But why should we think that this is really improvement rather than just a different thing that happens to the mind? Rather than it's frozen, it's I become a zombie criticizer rather than a zombie actor, zombie consumer.
Yeah.
So those are two questions.
All right, let's see. So first question about critique and why doesn't critique just, why can't that just become another sort of, sorry, another trap of cognition. I guess so like conceptually, I mean conceptually the answer is sort of cheap. You say, oh well I can't, right? Because critique is becoming self-aware. And so if you're just sort of like running through the same chains of reason over and over again, then necessarily you're not aware of what you're doing, because you wouldn't be doing that if you saw you were doing that. But like that's not that interesting and a little. The way to make that question interesting, I think, is actually just to look at Adorno's work and say, all right, this is why he's sort of like almost methodologically opposed to having a method, right? So Adorno's, or the closest he gets to having a method or sort of an approach or idiom, we could say, is the idea of the critical model, where there is actually no abstract structure of critique, right? Critique is always something that happens in particular encounters, whether it's with theory or with a literary text or with a condition of social behavior, it's always like a very direct confrontation with something that comes out of reality. And in thinking through that, you then arrive at these negative moments and you sort of abstract from it and come to understand it and understand how you don't understand it. But each work of his, I think, is an attempt to demonstrate that that happens, and I think it does demonstrate that that happens. But he can never get to the point where he says, and we know that this will always happen, right? And he can't explain why it'll always happen. He has some ideas about it, but he's rather averse to committing himself to that kind of claim. Now, the second one, restlessness of the mind. That, I don't know, it's the same kind of thing, right? It's like easy to deal with and hard to deal with. So maybe a few things to say about it. One, there are definitely a lot of, this is really the idea of immanent critique, right? That often restlessness of the mind can have a psychoanalytic basis. Maybe you're anxious, maybe you're neurotic, maybe you're like failing to come to terms with something in your life. And so that's what causes you to spiral around and never get anywhere in thinking about something. But you sort of say, like, three cheers for critique because we never stop going. Or maybe you employ another framework, right? I think Habermas actually pretty much treats critique as counter-argument. So I'm critiquing you because I criticize what you say. I respond to your argument with a counter-argument. But that's not necessarily critique in the sense that it doesn't necessarily come out of the same way of thinking, right? So, we get this in politics all the time, right? No, you're wrong that we need a federal bank because the government just mucks everything up and makes it worse. I mean, that's not immanent critique, right? That's not this idea that you adopt sort of the way of thinking that is to be criticized, and then you build it out internally, you try to understand it better, and then you realize that it breaks down. That's really just argument. And so the distinction to be drawn is between criticizing or arguing and immanent critique, which really depends upon reflection. And then we're kind of stuck in the same position where I have to say, well, yeah, it's possible to be skeptical of this. And it's possible to say, well, maybe it doesn't work, and maybe you're not going to get anywhere, and maybe you're misunderstanding it. But again, this is where Adorno's not really arguing this from other premises we're supposed to accept. He's really stating, no, as a matter of experience, as a matter of like experiencing thinking and knowing what it's like to think, you realize that there's a difference between the immanent concept of critique, between thinking out of something and seeing it fall apart, and just arguing back and forth or in circles. Great.
I guess, given the way you've articulated this conception of sort of like power and politics and economics as sort of determinant of our current thoughts and determinant of our ideologies, how do we know, or how can we access this sort of like magical reflective power of criticism that will allow us to sort of know when we're actually trapped in ideology and when we're not, be able to delineate the sort of good from the bad in that? And given that this sounds sort of like a very difficult process to do, how is it that sort of the everyday person, the person who might be, you know, enthralled to market economies to feed themselves, is that person necessarily doomed to sort of a bad consciousness, or they can't ever be critical, or how is that person able to be involved in the project, or can they be?
Yeah, so this is, Adorno was, not really for that reason, but somewhat relatedly, Adorno was criticized by many of his contemporaries and many people today for being an incredibly elitist thinker. It doesn't so much come out of his understanding of critique, but more because he sort of writes through his like intimate knowledge of many European literary and artistic traditions and musical traditions. And so reading Adorno is sort of like reading someone who seems to assume that you know everything about like the past 300 years of European intellectual and humanistic history, and that that's the only way to go along with him. One of my aims in articulating critique conceptually for him is to show that even though he writes through all of those thinkers, that's actually not what's central to his work. And the critique is actually not supposed to be a terribly difficult thing, right? Like, continuing to be critical is challenging. Sometimes it can be hard to critique certain beliefs, but actually, fundamentally, it really just is self-awareness, right? Becoming aware of your own ways of thinking about the world, and that can sort of vary in like how much content there is. But that's actually a moment that more or less everyone has at some point, we hope. And so it's really more it's really more about degree than possibility, right? To what degree can you become reflective of your beliefs, especially the ones that are situated in politics and economics and history? And to sort of poke at something you said initially, Adorno doesn't hold to a deterministic view of like consciousness or history, far from it. I mean, he actually doesn't make any theoretical claims about the nature of causation. He probably has some like generally Kantian views about it, but that's sort of incidental. The point is, he doesn't anywhere take on explaining like where ideas come from and could we think different thoughts. He's really just interested in like how self-reflection works critically. And so, sort of in summary, right, like critique is difficult in a way, but the activity of self-reflection actually is not. And so it's ultimately what should be a democratic thesis, because this is something that's just an inherent capacity of cognition, right? It's not based on knowledge, and it's not even really supposed to be esoteric. It's supposed to be something that we realize we do once we articulate.
One more question.
I take two. All right. Danny?
Maybe you just have to clarify this, but so, you know, considering what you say about Adorno and his negative dialectics and that critique is sort of like a never-ending process, and how you politicize that by saying that structures are an impediment to reason, like, isn't putting those two together inherently political by saying that, I mean, the structure is the impediment to reason, that's inherently political because that kind of breaks down all the structures that we think of. And then So then is politicizing it actually coming up with like a conclusion for his concept of critique, or like the only way to? You know what I mean?
Okay, I don't quite understand. I'm with you up to the end. Yes, I think it is a highly political kind of theory, albeit somewhat inexplicitly, but it's coming to a conclusion.
Right, so then politicizing it in that way by, like, politicizing it by saying
that, you know, that we then making Adornian critique into a structure that's...
Right, sort of.
Yeah. I mean, the aim really is to not end up with a structure, to sort of have, like, experience to some degree his understanding of critique, to not really to dance around it, but to say, all right, like, we can articulate intuitions of what it is to be critically reflective, but like I said, we never come up with really a method or a theory of critique. I think definitely, like, if we had a formulaic program for like what it is to be critical with some sort of like criterion to distinguish critical things from uncritical things, that would be politically dangerous in the same way. Christian?
Yeah. So you mentioned earlier that, in your answer to Professor Allen's question, that Adorno wasn't necessarily concerned with why or how people acquire their ideas. And I was curious, in the limited knowledge that I have of any of this, why that's the case. Because it seems to me that a theorist who's so concerned with things that revolve around ideology and reason would be concerned with why people think the way they do. Or at least would have written something on it or had something to say about it.
Yeah, I mean, in a sense, he is concerned with why people think the way they do, right? But that's really a matter of like seeing uncritical behavior and thoughtlessness. The reason I think he's not trying to explain where ideas come from and how we internalize them is more of a theoretical thing. That would really, like, that, you know, that would be like presenting a theory of the transmission of ideas rather than engaging in the critique of consciousness. And any sort of like solid conceptual structures are the kinds of things that Adorno wants to like break down and tear apart, not ultimately create himself. So I think he's just not disposed and doesn't really believe in coming up with that kind of explanatory theory.
Okay. We could go on, but I think we'll have to cut off there. So thanks very much.
Why don't I just take a shot? This bourgeois intellectualizer. What are we making the revolution? That was going to be my question.
Professor.
Hey.
I don't know. I imagine.
I didn't understand that one, but I understood pretty much. I read 65 pages out of the
book. Tonight you can
finish. I'll finish it right up. Danny, hi, Luca. Nice to meet you.